Good morning, church. Let's stand to our feet. Psalm 34 says that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. So this morning as we sing, let's lift high the King who has saved us, who's redeemed us. Let's bring him all the worship that he's due.
There's nothing feet, for I am saved. Oh, come on, church, we lift it up to Him today. When I fight, so when I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh, God, the battle belongs to You. Oh, every fear I lay at Your feet, I'll sing through the night. And oh, God, the battle belongs to You. Let's remind ourselves of this. And if You are for me, who can be against me? No one, no one. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible. Nothing can stand against. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand. Come on, church, we declare this together. Oh, mighty fortress, You go before us. Oh, nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in truth that the battle belongs to the Lord, that we worship from a position knowing that our God holds the keys to victory. And I love that we get to worship through song, but not only through song, but we get to worship through His word, and specifically declaring His word out loud. In Hebrews 4, it says the word of God is living and active. There's power in His word. And when we declare His word out loud, the lies of the enemy have to flee because the truth of God comes rushing in. And as we sing this next song, there might be a verse that God highlights in you, or you might have a verse already that wants to that you want to share with us. We're going to have leaders on each side, and if you're to be ever so bold to come up and line up after this next song, we're going to have a moment where we just start declaring and sharing these verses that are on your heart. Not only to strengthen and encourage us, but really to fill this space with the truth of God. So Jesus, we just ask for You to come. Speak to us now, even in this moment. Let there be a verse that comes to mind that strengthens the body of Christ. Open up our ears, open up our hearts. Give us boldness to share this. We love you and we worship you today. In Jesus' name.
Here in the power of God. Hello? Okay, there we go. At the Women's Conference, they did this verse, and I just had to repeat it. Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling.
Psalm 107, verses 1 through 3. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. Those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south.
Psalm 27, verses 13 and 14. I'm certain that I will see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart be courageous. Wait for the Lord.
Ephesians 6, 10 and 11. Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Romans 3, 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. Thank you for that truth.
Psalm 86, 8 through 10. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things, you alone, O God.
Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7. As you therefore have received Christ Jesus in the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving.
Hebrews 3, verse 1 to 4. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in the heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession, who was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses was also faithful in all God's house. For Jesus has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God.
Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
Because of Christ, I am.
punishment my peace. Oh, his punishment my peace. Come on, let's confess this together. May I never boast.
May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not forget the blood he shed. It is by his death I am alive. Oh, may I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. Oh, may
from the grave. We worship you, Jesus.
Well, all praise be to Jesus. He's the reason we get to be here. He's the reason that we have salvation. It's the reason we live. It's because of Jesus. And it's great to worship him. It's great to be together. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. My name is Larry Geisler. I get to serve here as our pastor of Harvest Students and Harvest Young Adults. It's great to be here. It's great to worship together. It's great to declare the name of Jesus, the power of Jesus together. And if this is your first time at Harvest, I just want to
give you a special welcome. We're so glad that you've joined us this morning. And so if you have any questions about our church or you just want to meet somebody, I'll be out in our lobby after the gathering. I would love to chat with you, would love to connect with you and answer any questions you might have about our church. But we're glad to have you here this morning. For everyone here, you might know we've mentioned it quite a few times at this point. We're using a new app for all the different systems and things of our church. It's called the Church Center app. And there's a couple things that we would love for you to engage in. One is the Connect card, so we can know that you're here, so that when you're not here, we can tap you on the shoulder and say, hey, we know it's important that you should be at church, and it's good for our perseverance in the faith and fellowship with one another. But also, if there's something going on in your life or a family member, something that you're praying towards, we want to pray with you. We're a prayer-dependent church, and we want to lift these things up to the Lord with you. So please also use that to submit some prayer requests so that our staff can be praying for those this week. And as we're talking about prayer, being dependent on God in our prayers, we're looking towards Easter. We're very, very excited to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, to see many, many people prayerfully come to know who he is, to be saved by the gospel, to be saved by the person of Jesus Christ. And so we want to be praying for that. And so I want to invite you to be a part of our 24-hour prayer session that's going to be happening Thursday, March 28th, before Good Friday at 6 p.m. to Good Friday, March 29th at 6 p.m. So you can go on the Church Center app. You can register for a one-hour slot of that 24 hours of prayer. If you're crazy, you want to be up in the middle of the night like Stephanie and I will be, you come at 3 a.m., you can pray with us, and we can be so excited and expectant for what God is going to do this Easter. So please join us at some point. You don't have to join us in the middle of the night, though I would love that. Come join us and pray towards Easter. And many of you might be thinking about who is somebody that I want to bring with me this year to Easter service. Who's somebody that God's uniquely planted me in their life that I can be somebody to bring them to the knowledge of the gospel. And so as you leave, there's a bunch of invites in the lobby. We'd love for you to take some of those with you that you can bring people to hear this necessary message for their salvation, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so there are a couple times you can do that. On Good Friday, we have two services, one at 5 p.m., one at 7 p.m. here. And then Easter weekend, we have our same weekend gathering times, a 5 p.m. service on Saturday night and 9 and 11 o'clock Easter Sunday. We'd love to see you and any of your friends, family, coworkers that the Lord would place in your life to bring with you. And now I just want to take some time. We're going to pray for a local gospel preaching church that's actually been planted out of Harvest Bible Chapel. It's City Line Bible Church in the community of Niles. So we want to pray for them and their pastor, Mo Zachariah, as they're preparing for Easter, as they're having their own gathering this morning, that God would just give them favor in their community and use them. Also, I want to turn our hearts towards the Lord in our giving. We know that the reason we're here is because of Jesus, and we know that everything that we have because of Jesus, that God has so graciously given to us. Deuteronomy 16:17 says this, that every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God that he has given to you. All of us have been given more than we deserve. Maybe it's not as much as the person sitting next to you or whatever, but we've all been given quite a bit. And if we love Jesus, if we recognize that all that I have is because God has given to me, man, I want to give to him and worship to him because he's been so good. And so you can give in any of the ways that you see on the screen here, but I just want to take some time to lift these offerings up to the Lord, pray for City Line, and pray for our gathering this morning. So would you join me? Father, we come before you humbly, knowing that there's nothing in us that would draw you to send your son to save us. But Lord, you didn't pass us by. Lord, you had compassion on us, and you sent Jesus for us that we would take hold of that which is truly life. Lord, we thank you for the life that we have in Jesus. We thank you that we get to gather this morning and worship you. And Lord, we thank you for churches that are doing the same. We thank you for City Line and how you're using them Lord, thank you for placing them in that community that we know that the gospel can reach Niles because there's a church there that's committed to making you known. And so, Lord, we pray that you use them. We pray that you give them favor, especially leading up to Easter. Lord, I pray that many come to know you because of what they are doing this Easter season. And Lord, I pray for Pastor Mo that you give him wisdom, that you give him guidance, that you speak through him this morning as he opens your word. Lord, we just pray that your spirit be amongst them and use them. God, we pray for all of our offerings. We pray for all this that we're cheerfully giving back to you. God, would you multiply it? Would you use it that people in our community might come to know you? Lord, we pray that we might serve our community. We pray that you might be glorified through our giving today. And Father, we pray as we open your word, we pray for Tommy as he's going to be faithfully preaching the truth of your word. Lord, I pray that you use him as a mouthpiece. Lord, I pray that you give us ears to hear a message that needs to be heard. So God, would you give us soft hearts that are ready to receive what you have for us? And Lord, we just devote this time and our attention to you. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We give this to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, you guys can go ahead and prepare for the teaching. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 13. But while you get there, why don't you stand up, find a brother or sister in Christ that's a part of your church family that maybe you don't know, and get to know them a little bit. This is our church family, so why don't you meet somebody new?
Church. Good to see you. Good morning. It's great to see you. Oh, man. Well, we're going to need a Bible this morning, and we're going to be in Matthew chapter 13, verses 47 through 50. And while you're turning there, I want to tell you about one of my hobbies. You might know this about me. I'm a bit of a hobbyist, and one of the hobbies that I really enjoy is fishing, and in particular, ice fishing. Any ice fishers out there? Oh, yeah, all two of us. Let's go. It's not very popular. Because it's cold, but if you've never been ice fishing, it is when the lake freezes over, you take out your gear and your ice shack or ice shanty, which is basically like a tent that keeps you warm when you're out there. You go out and you drill a hole through the ice and you fish. But that's really not the main attraction, is what happens in the ice shack. You've got a little pole, so you catch little panfish in there. The main attraction, because you want to catch bigger fish, is that around your ice shack, you drill some more holes and you put in things called tip-ups. And these, you could put some bigger bait on there to catch some bigger fish. You drop the line down, and when the fish takes the bait, there's a little flag on the top of the tip-up, and it pops up, so it lets you know that there's something on there. And so you're in your ice shack, just fishing away, having fun, staying warm, and the moment that you look out and see a flag, you run as fast as you have ever run before in your life. In fact, usually it gets pretty warm in the ice shack, so you like take off your jacket. So sometimes what happens is that tip-up goes off, you don't even put your jacket on. You're like, I am risking hypothermia to get that fish, whatever is on there. And so you run out, you hook the fish, you bring it up, you pull it up on the line, you bring it out of the hole. And usually the first thing that you do is you, if you're a catch, if you want to bring it home and eat it, right, usually you fish for things like maybe northern pike because they're a bit bigger, or walleye because they're delicious, right? They are good. And so you pull it out and you measure it because there are certain requirements. A fish has to be a certain length. There's a minimum length. And so where I fish in Wisconsin, usually I think it's 10 inches to 19 inches for a walleye. You can pull it out and eat it. That's a good eat right there. But 20 to 24 inches, you cannot pull it out of the lake. You got to throw it back in. And then anything over 24 inches, and if you get something over 24 inches, you get a walleye over 24. Oh, that's a good day. That is good eating right there. But there are requirements, right? And it's different for every fish. It's different even sometimes depending on the lake that you're fishing on. And so you could pull it out, you pull out, you measure it. Is it a good fish? Can you take it? Or is it a bad fish? You got to throw it back into the lake, right? And every fisherman knows this. There are requirements if you want to take the fish out of what size it needs to be. For a good fish to bring it out, or for a bad fish, you have to throw it back. And what we're going to see in our text today is something very similar to that. Jesus is going to give us a parable about fishing, which if you don't know what a parable is a small story with a big truth. It's a story talking about things in everyday life that there's actually attached a deeper spiritual meaning, right? In this case, in the parables that we're seeing, is the deeper meaning is the kingdom of heaven. We've been going through this series, the parables of the kingdom. And we've been taking different passes at the kingdom of heaven. And we've been getting a fuller picture of what it's like or what it's going to be like. And that's going to lead us all the way into Easter. So you got your Bible open? You ready? Matthew 13, starting in verse 47. We're going to go till 50. Let me give you just a little bit of context before we jump in. This is the only parable in this section that has an immediate explanation after it, right? So a couple of the parables, Jesus eventually explains those parables later on, but this is the one, this one has the explanation immediately after it. So Jesus gives the parable and then immediately gives the explanation of the parable. So it's a bit unique in that way. A parable like this, the parable of the net, is also a parable that we would call something like a warning parable or a judgment parable or a parable of judgment. That's the topic of the parable, is judgment. This is actually a very similar parable to the parable of the wheat and weeds. If you remember a couple of weeks back, Pastor Jeff preached on the parable of the wheat and the weeds. This is very similar to that with some uniqueness to it. And in some places, it's exactly identical. And any time that we see this, something similar, something repeated in the Bible, it's called biblical repetition. And this should catch our attention, right? It's the Bible shaking us. Hey, do you have this? Do you have this? Hey, listen, don't miss this. Listen, I said it once. I'm gonna say it again. Jesus, I said the parable once to farmers. They understood that. Maybe you need the fishing example. Maybe that's going to help a little bit, right? I want to make sure that you've got this. It's biblical repetition. It's important. And especially in a warning parable or a judgment parable, this is like a big, giant warning sign, right? If you're driving down the street and you get to a road closed, they have the giant fences, the orange and white fences with the big signs on them that says road closed, right? No through. Bridge out, danger, right? Don't go down this road. It's not going to end well, right? Big warning. That's biblical repetition here. Warning signs. Make sure that you have this. Make sure you understand this. So we're going to go through the parable. We're going to point out some unique emphasis, and then we are going to talk about some of the implications from the parable. So let's read it together. Matthew 13, starting in verse 47. It says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So let's look at the first unique thing about this parable, the unique emphasis, and that is on the net. The net. Look at verse 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. Now, maybe when you hear that and you think of like a net that was thrown into the sea, maybe you're thinking of like, you know, the people on the shore who have the circular nets that they can throw with their hands out into the water, and then they reel it back in real fast, and then they do it again and try to catch some fish. It's not a net like that. This would be a very large net, something called actually a drag net. And it would be something that they would attach to the boats that they would drag around in the water to capture as many fish as they can. In fact, I'm gonna draw it for you because I feel like I have to redeem myself from the semicolon debacle a couple of weeks ago. And I'm a terrible drawer, so this might not even redeem me. I don't know. But hopefully it'll give us a better understanding. That's a rectangle, all right? And this is the net, okay? This is the drag net. And what would be on a dragnet is you would have a very large net, and on the top of the net, you would have either flotation devices that keep the top of the net open, or they would attach them to the boat, so it keeps the top of the net afloat and open. And then on the bottom, they would have, you know, weights or things like that to keep the bottom of the net open as well. So you have a wide area for this dragnet, and little fish get caught in the net wherever it goes. Those are fish. Drawing. Redeemed? Maybe not. Thank you. But this is the idea, right? It is a large net that catches everything in its path, right? It was thrown into the sea and it gathered fish of every kind. You cannot do specific fishing with a net like this. It grabs everything in its path, every kind of fish, everything it grabs as it goes by. If you've ever seen any of those fishing shows on like the commercial fishing ships where they actually have dragnets and they pull them out of the water and it's just full of fish and they bring it onto the deck of the boat and they open it up and you've got all of these fish and some of them are different and they're like, well, we don't want those fish. And so they throw them overboard, right? Sometimes in the net they've got crabs and they throw those overboard as well. Sometimes it's an octopus. Sometimes it's, you know, there's different sea creatures in there because when you're fishing with a dragnet, it catches everything. Every single thing gets caught in the net. It catches everything. You're seeing the implication of the net now? It catches everything, which means that there is no escaping the net. And we're going to find out that the net is going to be brought ashore and they are going to... The fish that are in the net are going to be sorted, good and bad. There's judgment that is going to take place. So this net that catches everything is eventually going to bring everything in that net into judgment, okay? It is a large net, catches everything. You cannot escape it. You cannot escape the coming judgment that is ahead. It catches everything, everything in its path. Now, there are people in this world who think that they will escape the coming judgment, that they won't get caught in the net. They think, oh, I don't believe in God, so I'm not gonna get judged. They're in the net. Everyone is caught in the net. No one escapes the net. Or maybe if I don't think about it, if I just put it out of my mind, it's not real, caught in the net. Maybe you think, I can weasel out of it, you know? If I just swim fast enough, I could get away, I can escape the net. There is no escaping the net. It catches everything and everyone. If I just hide my sin, then God won't see it, and I won't be judged. Everyone is in the net and will come into judgment. The Bible says as much all throughout the scriptures, Matthew 25:31, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations. Just some? No, all of the nations. And he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. 2 Corinthians 5:10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Revelation 20. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which was the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. No one escapes the net. Everyone who is living, everyone who is dead comes before the judgment seat of Christ. All, everyone, everyone, everywhere from all time come before the judgment seat of Christ. There is no escaping it. So that should have some implications on our life. If that's true, if we are caught in the net, I'm caught in the net, you're caught in the net, our friends and family are caught in the net, everyone in the world who has ever lived is caught in the net and is going to stand before the King of Kings in judgment, that should have some serious implications for us. It should change the way that we live, shouldn't it? If we know that we're going to stand before the God of the universe in judgment for what we have done, that should change how we live. That should pervade every attitude and action that I have. It should motivate me to obey God's word. This should have massive implications. No one escapes the judgment. We will all stand before the Lord in judgment. So that's the net. The next unique thing in the parable that we see is the fish. Let's read verse 48. It says, when it was full, the net, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So we start with when it was full. When the time of the fishing is done, the scriptures in the next verse are going to say, so it will be at the end of the age. Okay, so when it was full, at the end of the age, if you remember the drawing that Pastor Jeff gave, the little diagram that he gave from a couple weeks ago, talking about the kingdom of God and the kingdom of man, that kingdom of God was ushered in with Christ, and there will be a time when the consummation of the kingdom of God happens, and the kingdom of man or the kingdom of this world will come to an end. At the end of the age, right? That's when the net is full, right here. This is the moment when the net is full, at the end of the age, at the consummation of the kingdom of God. We live in this part right here in the net. At the consummation of the kingdom, when the net is full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So notice the intentionality here of the fishermen sitting down. So they pull the catch onto shore, then they sit down so that they can get close to the catch, so that they can closely examine each fish. Is it good or is it bad? Do you see it? Close examination. There's not going to be a mistake. There's not going to be a good fish that gets thrown out. There's not going to be a bad fish that gets put into the good containers. It is careful examination. There's not going to be a mistake of what is a good fish and what is a bad fish. No mistake is going to happen. Carefully examined. I felt this way when I was doing my taxes in the past couple of weeks. Anyone? I was carefully examining, right? I don't want any trouble with the IRS, all right? I don't even know who those guys are, but that terrifies me a little bit, you know? So I'm checking every single column. Is that right? Did I put too many zeros? Because that would be a catastrophe. Did I not put enough zeros? That would be also a catastrophe. Any wrong move, any slip of the finger, extra digit, disaster, right? So careful examination of every single square on that tax return filing and just making sure that there is absolutely no mistake, getting close up to it, making sure that it is all good. That's the idea here. Getting close, examining the good fish, the bad fish, so that there is no mistake of what is a good fish and what is a bad fish. So they sat down and they sorted the good into the containers, but threw away the bad. The question here that comes out of this parable is what makes a good fish good and what makes a bad fish bad? By what measurement is a good fish good? By what requirement is a good fish good? By what standard is a good fish good and a bad fish bad? In the next verse that we're going to see in just a moment, we know that this is a symbol of righteousness and evil. So what makes a righteous person righteous and what makes an evil person evil? By what measure or standard or requirement are they good or are they bad? Is it their morals? Is it their system of belief of what is good and bad? And if that's a good enough moral system, then they're considered good people. Is it the good deeds that they do? If I've got a list, I've got a tally, and if I have done more good deeds than I have bad deeds, then I am a good person. Is that what it means when they're talking about good? Does that make a good fish good? What could it possibly be that makes a good fish good? What is the requirement? What is the standard? They're righteous because why? Because of good deeds? No. Right? God's standard, God's requirement, God's measurement for a good fish to be good, God's standard to enter the kingdom of heaven is perfection. It is perfection. So what is a good fish? It is a perfect fish. God's standard to enter the kingdom of heaven, to be good, is perfection. Right? Matthew 5:48. You therefore must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. The standard is perfection. Now you'd be like, well, that's a bit of trouble because I'm not perfect. I've sinned. I've lied. I've gossiped. I've cheated. I've stolen. Gotten angry. I've hated another person. I'm not perfect. Well, the scripture agrees with you. Romans 3:10-12. As it is written, none is righteous. Are you sure? Yep, no, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good. Not even one. Not even one. No one is righteous. No one is considered good. No one is considered righteous. Not even one. And in fact, even the righteous deeds that we try to do are not up to the standard of God's righteousness. Isaiah 64:6, we have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like polluted garment. Even our righteousness that we try so hard to have is seen as a polluted garment. So we have a big problem. We have a big problem. God's standard is perfection, and we cannot meet that standard. Even when we try our hardest, we are still not considered righteous. So how is it that we can be considered a good fish? How is it possible that we could be considered a good fish? 2 Corinthians 5 says, for our sake, we couldn't do it on our own. Our righteousness wasn't enough. For our sake, he made him, Jesus, to be sin, who knew no sin, who was perfect, perfection, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Romans 3:22, the righteousness of God. How do I get that? Through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. Romans 5:9, since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. This is such an important word for us, Christian, justified. That when we place our faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone for our salvation, we are justified. Which, if you think about it like a courtroom, we're standing before the judge, we are the defendant, but we have trusted in the name of the Lord. We have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. We are considered justified, even though we are completely guilty, even though we have sinned and we are wicked and we are not righteous and we are not good, because we have placed our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we are justified, not guilty, forgiven. But not only are we forgiven, we are given the righteousness of Christ. So that when God looks at us, he doesn't see the wickedness. He sees the perfect righteousness of his son, Jesus Christ. This is the miracle of the gospel. This is the miracle. That word is so important. You and I, when we place our faith in Jesus, are justified, not guilty, imputed the righteousness of Christ, meaning that it covers us. And when we are looked upon by God, judgment, he sees the righteous, the perfect righteousness of Christ, perfection. How are we considered a good fish? It's not about anything about us. The only defining characteristic of a good fish is the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's it. That is the only characteristic, the perfect righteousness of Christ that covers us when we put our faith and trust in him. Praise the Lord. So we have the net, we have the fish, and then finally, we have the result. We have the result. verse 49 and 50. So it will be at the end of the age. This age is coming to an end. The net will be full, and the angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them, the evil, the wicked, into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Weeping and gnashing of teeth. So end of age comes, the net will become full. We're all caught in the net of judgment. It brings us to the consummation of the kingdom. In that moment, there will be a judgment. The angels will go and they will separate the evil from the righteous. The righteous will enter into the eternal kingdom of heaven, and the wicked will be thrown into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The idea here, the weeping and gnashing of teeth, is extreme pain. Extreme pain. Think about the most painful thing that has ever happened to you in your life. Maybe you've broken a bone. Maybe you've, I don't know, got a big gash somewhere. Maybe you've never had that pain. I think there's one thing that we can all agree on, is that stubbing our toe is one of the worst of those pains, right? Or stepping on a Lego, right? These are all very painful experiences. And what do you do when you are encountered with that type of serious pain? What do you do? Well, maybe you'll yelp first, but we have a little bit of weeping and gnashing of teeth. Do you know? Oh, my goodness, my toe. Oh, right? It's the clenching of our teeth. The weeping through the clenched teeth. Now, this does not sound like a good time, right? Weeping and gnashing of teeth, the place where the wicked go. And yet we have so many different views of this place, right? The language that Jesus is using here is the language, this is hell. This is hell. And there are many different views of hell. I've heard it said more than I care to admit, that hell is going to be a party. Have you heard this before from people? Oh man, I'm just gonna go and party with all my friends down there. We're gonna do all the fun things that, you know, debauchery forever and ever and ever. It's gonna be a blast. I get to see all of my sinner friends there. It's gonna be great, right? Have you ever heard this before? Hell's gonna be a party in the place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. I don't think so. Some people think that hell just doesn't exist. They don't think that it's a place. It's not a real place. It's a state of mind. It's a state of being. Or that hell isn't eternal punishment. It's somehow temporary, or it's maybe immediate soul annihilation. That's what hell is. So what I want to do is I just want to take a walk through a quick theology of hell, because Jesus is talking about it right here, and I think it's important that we understand what is this place that Jesus is talking about. Jesus, in fact, talks about hell quite a bit. So what is it? What is this place, this fiery furnace, this place that is weeping and gnashing of teeth? What is it? What is it like? Well, first, it's eternal. It's eternal. Matthew 25:47. And these, the wicked, will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Notice the contrast between eternal life and eternal punishment. Eternal life forever for the righteous in the kingdom of heaven, right? Contrasted to the eternal punishment of hell. They go on forever, eternal. The next thing about hell is not only is it eternal, but it is punishment. It is punishment for the crime of not believing in an eternal, holy, perfect God who has revealed himself through his son, Jesus Christ. The punishment is eternal. In fact, 2 Thessalonians says the same. In flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction, away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. So hell is eternal, it is punishment, and it is torment. Revelation 20:10 says, and the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire, hell, where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Just four verses after this, in Revelation 20:14, then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. What happens in the lake of fire? Tormented day and night forever and ever. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, anyone who has not put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Which, what happens in the lake of fire? Tormented day and night forever and ever. Eternal punishment, torment. The theological phrase we use for hell is eternal conscious torment. It is eternal conscious torment. A little transparency for you this morning. I know this. I've known this for a long time. And maybe you have too. Maybe you've grown up knowing this. But sometimes it goes into the back of my mind. I get distracted with other things, and this isn't something that's at the forefront of my mind. But in my study this week, this right in the front, and I have to tell you that this absolutely wrecked me. It wrecked me. Because maybe you're like me, and you have loved ones who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ. I can't help but think of my dad, who has not placed his faith and trust in Jesus. And if he continues, this is his eternity. And that terrifies me. And maybe you have that same feeling. You have family members who have just not made the decision for Christ. This has massive implications upon our life and upon the lives of those around us. Massive. That there is a net that none can escape that is taking us towards a judgment in which there will be a judgment between good and bad. And that the only way to be considered good is through faith in Jesus Christ alone. Apart from that, you are considered wicked and you are thrown into the fiery furnace where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Hell, eternal conscious torment. This has massive implications for you and me. The first is a personal one. Are you the good fish or are you the bad fish? Are you the good fish or are you the bad fish? Listen, the net is not yet full. The age has not yet ended. You can put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ today, right now. And if you do, you will be justified, not guilty, forgiven. And not only forgiven, but given the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ so that you will be counted as the good, as the righteous. And you will spend eternity in the kingdom of heaven. You could do that today. Don't wait. Follow Jesus Christ today. Receive the forgiveness that he has for your sins and receive his imputed righteousness. The second implication is, are you trying to share the gospel with those around you in the net? The net is not yet full. The age has not yet come to an end. This reality of coming judgment that is inescapable and the reality, the two realities of eternal life and eternal punishment. This reality should move you and I to radical, wild, urgent evangelism. To anyone who is in our life, to tell them the good news, the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Charles Spurgeon says, if sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies. And if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped about their knees, imploring them to stay. If hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let no one go unwarned or unprayed for. Don't wait to tell those around you the good news of Jesus Christ. The net is not yet full. The age has not yet ended. This should move us to wild evangelism. If we say that we love them, the most loving thing that we can do for them is to bring this to them, to implore them to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. This should move us. The net is not yet full. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for our time in your word. Even in hard passages like this, this is the reality, the spiritual reality that awaits us all, Lord. So Lord, I just pray right now that as we consider our own lives, if we are in the category of good fish, not because of anything that we've done, but only because of the perfect righteousness of your Son, Jesus Christ, as we consider that for our own life, Lord, would you show us if there's someone who hasn't made that decision to put their faith and trust in you, would they do it today? The net is not yet full. And Lord, I pray for all of us who have made this decision to follow you, who are justified by your blood. Lord, I pray that you would give us a supernatural boldness and courage to go out and to witness, to tell everyone that we come across the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, help us. We need your help with this. Give us courage. Give us the words to speak. Give us the encounters to have with family and friends and those who we bump shoulders with throughout our daily life. And let us just be walking witnesses, imploring everyone we come across to trust and have faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, be with us this week as we do that. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we close. Let's make this our prayer today.
I'm poor.
truth cuts like an arrow. I will say it anyway. 'Cause here I am.
But it will be. The day is coming when we have to answer. And so, if you haven't responded to the offer that Jesus has extended to you to say, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I want to follow Jesus. You need to. Please come and to the front. We'll have pastors and leaders would love to pray with you and talk to you about what it means to know Jesus, to follow Jesus. And for all of us, if we love the people in our lives, what we have to do is to tell them what is coming. The enemy would love to tell us that's not important. We don't have to do it, but we do. And so look, if this is your first time, thank you for coming. I would love to talk to you out in the lobby, but for all of us here, regardless if you're first time or whatever, we have to respond to the truth of God's word. And so as you go and you love people by sharing this message with them, remember that you are loved.